Welcome to Practical Rifle Training and Reviews. The first review that we're bringing you is the Steiner M5Xi 3x15 with the MSR reticle in it. This particular unit was sent into us by the good guys at Beretta Australia. So a huge shout out to those fellas in there. They're more than helpful and willing to release this scope for us for testing. It is based on a military application, so we did tell them when we received this scope that we were going to be putting it through vigorous testing. We weren't just going to take it down to the range and let a few rounds off. We wanted to try it into a few different applications and take it out hunting, see how everything performed, see how the turrets performed, see how the reticle performed in competition formats. So basically, I'm not going to go into any of the specs and tab data on this. You can sit there and get onto the manufacturer or email myself through the links below or the good guys at Beretta. They'll be more than helpful to answer any of your questions. So the testing that we're going to be doing through the duration of the next couple of days, or weeks I should say, we're going to take it out into a hunting environment, test the turrets, see how easy they are to use in the field under pressure, see how easy it is to track moving targets with the reticle, check out the ranging features inside the reticle. Also testing, see how good the glass is at those less than ideal conditions. The idea with putting it into the PRF style matches was to see how quickly you'd sit there and acquire targets within the mag range settings that we've got here. Also moving between targets on your turret, see how easy you can quickly maneuver. That this turret system is really above and beyond what I've used in the past. So without further ado, we'll get into a few videos and we'll go through and explaining each part of this optic in a little bit more detail. So stay tuned. So the testing that we put this through, we spoke to Beretta, and this year it was designed for a military application or an application that shares those same aspects. So we wanted to put it in those sorts of environments to test it. We didn't want to just take it down the range and stuff around with it and then write a quick review up. We wanted to go out there, try to get some video footage of what we're actually doing. The hunting one, what we wanted to do in a hunting environment was to test the clarity of the glass and how it's picking up game at certain distances on those less than ideal lighting conditions. We also wanted to see how it was utilizing the mag going in and out of different targets quickly. Also, how the MSR reticle went tracking game, not firing at moving targets, but seeing what sort of magnification worked best for that reticle in the field. So we found wood sitting probably around your 10-12 was probably the best one. You could sit there and pick up a wide field of view, and the reticle was still pronounced to a point where you didn't have any drums picking up or seeing the reticle on game colours. The other thing we wanted to see is how stressful these here are, the turrets were to use in those quick engagements where a deer might pop up and you've got to engage quickly. So we didn't have any drums with any of that. We're very happy with how this performed in the field. The one thing that we did, we were dragging these through doing some stalks and all that on some deer. Andy had his T-series, so Andy's got the T-series of this, which is the one, next one below this. So he'll have his review up on his page as well, so check that one out. You'll see both these scopes side by side. So they're going through the same tests. The second test that we put it through was, we wanted to utilize this in a comp format. So we were sort of lucky enough, it was good timing. We had a competition, sort of like a PRS style format, shooting off barricades, shooting at different colored targets, different shaped targets, and different times of the day. So I was very interested in getting this up there to test that out. One, because of the glass, we're gonna be shooting in less than ideal conditions. We're gonna be shooting at different colors and different shapes. So I really wanted to see how that glass performed. It performed exactly how I thought it would, didn't have any dramas with it. The other thing that we wanted to test was how easy it was to manipulate these turrets going back and forth from your long distance engagements to your short distance to your CQB type shoots. For the shoot that we went to, we didn't get a chance to get into the second rev. So Andy and I, we did go out for shoots and all that and put it under some time restraints and utilizing that second rev and jumping in between the top and second rev. So no dramas whatsoever there time wise or trying to get onto your call. Very happy with it. Like I said, that's the sort of application that it was designed to do, and it really shone through, didn't have any dramas, and it performed exactly how I'd expected to perform. Alright, so the third test that we've done was the bastardized tracking slash tall target test. The reason why I say bastardized is because ideally I would like to have had a vise of some sort and sat the rifle in there and then got a phone scope or a target scope or something like that and sat behind the eyepiece and given you guys a first person view of what the reticle is actually doing while it's moving up and down the target. Just so you can gauge how this tall target slash tracking test went. What I've done is I've fired two rounds here just to give you an understanding of how I'm shooting with this ammunition to see how much you're actually going to take out of this test here. So you can see it's well under half an inch, so that's half an inch variation in this. I'm going to call it good. So the reason why a tall target test should be done with the optics when you get them is to make sure that you're actually dialing what you want the scope to dial. So if you want to dial 9mm, you want to make sure it's dialing 9mm. If you want to dial 15, you want to make sure it's dialing 15, not 14.8, which is what the tall target test is all about. So it's about finding out where there, if there is a variation in what your scope's actually tracking like and being able to account for it, or you can send it back to the manufacturer and get them to rectify it if that is a drama. So with this one here, I could only get to 9mm on this particular target for the day. I would like to have gotten out to around 15 or any more above 10 anyway. So you can see here, this one here is your vertical string. So before you start doing this sort of test, you want to make sure that you're plumbing your line up with your frame. So you're just plumbing your frame up and having this bent over like this, because your scope's going to track perfectly in a line and you're going to be missing all your targets. So you're going to think that there's a drum with your scope when in actual fact you just haven't plumbed your line up. So make sure it's plumbed up. You can see here this is all falling well within half a minute of what I'm shooting over here. So I'm going to call this good. It's staying perfect. The top one was slightly off center, so was the first one, but that could be me as well. What's going to happen if there is something wrong, you're going to start seeing it deviating on the one line most of the time. You start seeing creep out either to the right or the left. This one here, I can sort of tell it's me because this one's pretty much on, that one's slightly off there, and this one's slightly to the left here, so that's just a shooter error. With your windage, I've done the same thing, the same concept. So I've wound this one here all the way to the left, so you're 6.7 or 6.8 mils left. Wound it back, engaged the 2mm mark. Done the same, all the way up to the right, come back to zero, engaged again. So you can see this tracking test worked fine. We've done this on a number of different calibers, so we've done it on a 338. We've done it on the 7mm, which is the target rifle, competition rifle that we had. We've done it on a 308 and the 300 Norma. So in all tests, we had the exact same results. So in my opinion, the scope's fine, it tracks fine. No dramas at all. So what we'll do now, we'll get into some of the close-up videos or the turret systems and moving back into some of the scope features itself. Alright guys, so we'll start off with the turret systems that Steiner have come up with for the M5Xi model. So with this one here, we'll start with the elevation. This here has a total of 26 mils. We'll get to that in a minute. But the main feature and probably the biggest selling point of this particular optic here is how they have navigated around not having to have a rev indicator that protrudes out the side of their scope turret, or having to have lines where you have to keep coming back and referencing down the turret itself. So what they've actually come up with is, as you spin your turret around, when you get to your 13mm, as you start getting around to your second rev, you'll start seeing that original sleeve start going up into the top of the turret, revealing a second lot of numbers on the bottom. Now the good thing about this is they just continued on the numbers. So you're on 13mm there, 14, 15, all the way around. If you want to get to 22, straight around to 22 and you're there. So I'll just quickly go around. So you've got 26mm of elevation with 0.8 over travel. So you've actually got 26.8 mils of usable elevation there. This here is already zeroed for a 7mm 08 on a 20mm 08 rail, and I can still get 26.8 out of that. So I'll just show you the sleeve system again. So you're going back to your first rev. So now you're back down onto your first rev now. I'm a huge fan of having zero stops on zero, but this here isn't a drama whatsoever. You can sit there and go to whatever. Okay, that's maxed out. Two clicks, you know you're back on zero. The thing that I like about that is when you're doing your nighttime shoots and you're not allowed white light while you're firing, you're never ever going to get lost on your
on your Zero. You see some now that'll have 2 MOA under travel. It's a good idea and all that sort of stuff, and I understand why they do that. But when you're doing your nighttime shoots, if you're trying to sit there and chase 1 mil, you gotta sit there and guess when 1 mil is. And it just takes up that extra bit of time. This one here, you go straight back to, you're there, you're ready to go. So that's one thing I love about that. On top of the turret cap, they've got little indents up there, which make it really easy to grip hold of this turret, regardless of whether you've got gloves on, no gloves, or you've got sweaty hands. So that's another cool feature. You see some other ones, they might have really little small ones, and it actually starts hurting your hand after a while because you're slipping a lot of the time. Not the case with the Steiner turrets. Moving across to the right hand side, we're now onto our windage. So with this one here, you've got 6 mils left and 6 mils to the right. Now this here also has, I think it's 0.9 or 1 complete mil of over travel, left and right. So you've actually got close to 7 mils left and right. You can hear, just by turning that, the clicks are very audible. You can't mistake them at all. So the top of the turret cap is the same as your elevation here in the way of your little grooves here to grip onto. Okay, so moving on to the elevation, the illumination. So you've got two offsettings. You got an offsetting at the start and an offsetting at the end. So you got 11 different modes of elevation you can use. So basically 1 to 7, so 1 through to 7, that there is your nighttime operations. So you're using that for nighttime shooting. Within that 1 to 7, 1 to 4 is actually utilized at night when you're using your NVGs or some sort of night vision device with this scope. From 7 onwards, you are looking at standard daytime mode, so your reticle will be illuminated easy enough so you can see it from your 8 to 11, I think it is, sorry. So that's your illumination. In between here, your hole numbers. So in between your hole numbers, you sort of got like a standby feature, so it doesn't turn it off, but it just puts it into like a lazy or a sleep mode. So to turn it off completely, you have to wind it around from the start or to the finish to turn it off completely. Just to the right of the illumination, and just get to it, you've got your parallax. So the parallax is still on the left hand side of the optic, but just to the right of your illumination. So your parallax starts at 50 and goes all the way around to 1000, and then keeps spinning it around a little further and you get to infinity. But all in all, the turret systems are probably the best turret systems I've seen on the market so far, and it'll take a lot to beat how these guys have actually set this particular turret system up. Not just on their elevation and that there, but having everything so user-friendly and streamlined, we can quickly get to it, and you can actually see it along your scope wherever you got your head sitting. But that's the turret systems. What we'll do, we'll move back now to the magnification ring, and we'll have a quick talk about that. Alright, so this is the magnification ring, or the magnification band that comes with this optic. This is the 3x15, obviously. Now this is the only gripe that I did have with this scope was I would really have liked to either see this the grip here be a little bit longer. Just so you can sit there, if you've got sweaty hands, it's a lot easier to grip. This still works, but as soon as you get into a hunting environment or you start doing PRF-style matches where your hands are sweaty, you might not have gloves on. I did find myself slipping off this quite a lot. If I wanted to try to get back to a specific magnification range quickly, I was slipping off this. Not a big gripe at all, it's just a personal preference. The T series underneath this one actually comes with a throw lever. A throw lever may be a little bit too big or too extreme, but I would like to see this here, this little indent here, a little bit more pronounced, just for that particular reason. This here is based on a military style application, so you are going to have gloves on, or they designed it for gloves and that, obviously, but if you don't have gloves on, it does hinder you a little bit if you're moving between magnification ranges. that the one thing that I was concerned about was the first PRS match we went to was up in Darwin, top end of Australia, and it was around 40, 45 degrees. I had some dramas with scopes previous to this or prior to this, with this little band lifting up and coming unbound with what it was stuck to, and just become slippery, and this here would actually just free spin, so it wasn't actually locked onto anything. This here, it wasn't the case with this one, it stuck on there very well. So that was one thing I paid particular attention to, and I was using this quite a bit going between the mag ranges, so I did put it to the test quite well in those conditions. We also drug this scope through the sand quite a lot when we're doing our hunting tests with it, and no sand could actually get in there, so we had sand and dripped over it and all that sort of stuff, thinking that it might bind it up or get stuck in there and becomes gritty. Didn't have any dramas with it whatsoever. It's nice and tight in there, you're not going to get that off. So I really like that as well. Alright guys, so that wraps up the review for the Steiner M5Xi 3x15 with MSR reticle. Once again, I'd like to thank the guys at Beretta Australia for sending us this unit to review. Greatly appreciated. Without the manufacturers getting on board and sending us in some units that you guys want us to review, it's going to be very hard to keep up with the newer gadgets that are coming out on the market today. We will be doing reviews on the stuff that we're using in our courses as well, and a lot of that stuff's the new stuff coming out anyway, so keep updated with the channel. There's a couple of links at the bottom there. You can go across to Andy's webpage. I'll be sharing that webpage with him and posting up all the reviews that we do. Any questions in regards to this particular Opti, you can get onto myself at the links below, or the good guys at Beretta. So I'll tag them in this as well, and you can contact them directly. But overall, brilliant unit. I definitely recommend this unit for people getting into your long range precision or anything to do with any field use. You could definitely use this for your target applications as well, but it is a front focal plane. In my opinion, the reticle doesn't blow out on max power enough to justifying throwing this out of the arena for not electing this scope for a target scope, because it can definitely be used as a target scope. Sitting around the 3600-3800 mark, I think it's pretty much dead on the price range of what you're actually getting in the way of features for this optic. So I think the price range is pretty much dead on. Like I said, it's got brilliant glass, one of the best turret systems on the market. You've got a lot of elevation, and it's not bulky even with a 34mm tube. Like I said, the only thing that I would like to have seen was maybe a more pronounced lever on your magnification band. And that's pretty much it. Very impressed with it. In the way of other reviews and that, if you guys want us to keep doing these reviews and keeping on top of stuff that's coming into the shooting arena, just get on to us using the links below, and we'll see if we can contact the manufacturers and get these units out for us to test for you guys. So stay tuned, and we'll get some more reviews up for you shortly.